Good evening. I am Charlie Steinbeck, the director of the Berman Museum. Thank you all for coming tonight to the ninth Berman Conversation. As you know, previous conversations have been with Ursinus faculty, and now we're sort of casting the net a tad wider to include sort of regional professionals, but we didn't take any risk because Matthew Affron is the Philip and Muriel Berman curator at the Philadelphia Museum of Art. So we're just being a little careful before we go too wild out there. And we also have Matthias Schaller with us tonight. First thing, I need to ask to turn off your cell phones. We would hate to have some odd ring interrupt the conversation. These are intended as conversations, they're not interviews. And the people are here, they just met an hour or so ago, and from what I've seen so far, it's gonna be a quite interesting evening. In preparing for tonight, I was sort of thinking about why I sort of fell in love with these photographs when they were first shown to me by my old friend, Antonio Homan. And I then started thinking, how long have I known Antonio? And I don't think he remembers this, but the first time that you and I ever met was in 1979, when I was doing my very first exhibition, and I came to the Sonnabend Gallery to look at some work by John Baldessari. And so I've known Antonio for close to 40 years now. And you know, I see him once in a while, and I don't see him for 8 years, and then I see him again. And the last time I saw him 2 years ago, he showed me this work by Matthias Schaller. I didn't know what to think about it at first. It was beautiful, but then I thought, is it just beautiful, and what is the substance there? But then I remembered something that was sort of significant to me as a curator, and something that has always been a part of why I like the job I have as being a curator and a museum director. And that is going to artist studios. I think going to the studio is one of the most interesting things, one of the most telling things, and as someone who organizes art exhibitions, being able to see how artists function, how they think, becomes quite apparent when you see their studios. The same is true when you look at their palettes. It really tells you something about how they think. The great story that I love to tell, and my wife loves to hear it, because one of my contemporary art heroes is Bruce Nauman. And I was fortunate to be in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and I went out and was chatting with his lovely wife, the painter Susan Rothenberg, and she said, would you like to go see if Bruce is around? And I said, love to. And walked into Bruce's studio, which is about three times the size of the gallery. And it was interesting because I was totally confused, because it didn't look like anything that an artist could actually function in. It didn't look like a space that even a human could function in. Basically, it was a giant room full of trash. It was a floor, you know, every surface of the floor was covered. Boxes, papers, there was a few feet swept away, and the only thing I could say is, Bruce, what are you working on? And he went on to tell me something. So we're pleased tonight to have Matthias Schaller, who is an artist from Germany, has done many different projects and had numerous exhibitions that I think he will share some of that with you tonight. I think this is the first time that Matthias and I have met. We've spoken a few times on the phone, several emails, but it's really great to, as I said, finally meet the artist and understand more about who he is. Matthew Affron, as I said, is at the Philadelphia Museum of Art. He's done a lot of fabulous exhibitions while he's been here in Philadelphia. His most recent project, he just said he returned from Tokyo, working on an exhibition of Marcel Duchamp's work from the Philadelphia Museum collection. So, as I said, I'm gonna remind Matthew and Matthias, this is a conversation, not an interview. So guys, go to it. Thank you, welcome.
Joey, thank you very much. Matthias, it's a pleasure to be here and to meet you.
Thank you.
To see your works. And I'm very happy to see everyone here assembled in this beautiful gallery. I have all sorts of questions, but I've been told more than once that's not an interview, so I'm just going to start and then we're going to see where it goes. I do think that when you're surrounded by a body of work like this, it's important to know where it comes from and to give some sense of what set the stage for it. So I thought I would start by just saying that we're in a gallery with a selection of about 30,
is it
about
30? 27.
27 examples of a series that began in 2007, which now numbers about 200 or more photographs of palettes of art from artists. You could even, I'm even hesitated over my wording there. Are they by artists? Are they from artists? Are they of artists? They're artist palettes. Truth in Advertising, we just did some redecorating here. So why don't you, why don't you introduce the three palettes so we can start somewhere.
Okay. So hello, good evening. First of all, I want to thank you, Charlie, very much, and Antonio also, and initially also Matthew here, that we can have this talk now. Please go ahead with questions you want to make, also the how all this comes up, the series. Yes, we have three palettes here that they are very also be seen on the camera easily. It's Site Wombly. It's Picasso in the middle, and it's Van Gogh. We have three periods also with...
We have running on your shirt.
Three periods for these three palettes. Should I keep it in mind?
That's hard.
It's much better now. It's much better. Should I repeat?
Sure.
It'll be difficult.
We're redecorating, we're also...
Adornment.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
There, because of the electric block. Did you have? Yeah.
Yep. We'll be back.
Good. Sorry for that. Site Wombly, Picasso, and Van Gogh. These three palettes we wanted to have in our background. So because I think we will talk about those palettes for sure.
So what's obvious as you look around is that these works are in a series. So the question of the series is very important. There's also the presentation of them. The first thing I noticed is that these palettes are in what you might call the display rather than the use orientation. Because look at the thumb holes. Mm-hmm. Right? The thumb holes are not close. Do you want to demonstrate the let's
I want to become a painter for some seconds.
So when you hold the palette, that's when the hole is there for your thumb. But it also indicates the relationship of the board to your body, right? And your point of view. Whereas it seems to me that the palettes pretty consistently, the ones that have thumb holes, they're up, they're not down. Which is the way you sometimes see palettes in still lifes. Mm-hmm. In other words, or even hung on a wall. For example, there's a very famous painting by Georges Braque, made in the first decade of the 20th century, one of the most famous. One of those cubist still lifes that you go to when you want to teach people about what is cubism. It's called Still Life with Violin and Palette. And the whole game is that the palette is actually hanging on a nail in the studio, which I think is a normal thing to do, right? And that's the orientation that I see of the palettes in these frames, which means that Matthias is making a relationship between the palette and the picture, but also the palette as an object to hold and to use, and the palette as an object to hang on the wall and to look at. This is my crazy hypothesis.
Yes, and my crazy decisions, or the reasons why I came up to this order was another one, because I wanted to liberate the palette from its natural daily use as a tool, taking it away from there, because I say, it's for me, it's not a tool. I want to show you that this is a kind of artwork, that this is an abstract of the artistic production of these individuals. So two operations I did, one was maybe more, three. So if it's there, I lift it up and I liberate it from his body, sure, and that's it.
So there are some very interesting and very tendentious things that you just said. For example, you said that it's a picture, or you.
I want to propose it as a picture.
You want to propose it as a picture, right? And that idea has a very interesting history, which I think this whole body of work puts us in mind of. That's one thing to talk about. But even before we talk about the pictorial quality of these works, I'd like to talk about the series and the way they're presented and set the stage. I thought I might ask you in just a few words to tell us something about what came before. Starting around 20 years ago, or a little less, you started making series of photographs. And your early series were mostly series of interiors and of architectural spaces and even some exteriors, as far as I know. So, can you say something about what led you to becoming a photographer and to becoming a photographer interested in serial photographs? First through the photographs of interiors, and then we could maybe move to this series.
Yeah, and so why I became a photographer in series and interiors? And for sure, interiors is the thing that was the object that interested me the most, because I shared with Charlie that I had not experiences with artist interiors, with artist studios, with my first series. I did, they were not, do you hear me? Is my
yeah. Yeah.
Eric Sella.
You're fine.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Good.
But, I mean, I was maybe also not so much aware why I was pulled into interiors, but it's speaking to me very much.
Mm-hmm. So we're speaking of a series of photographs of interiors of photographer studios,
yeah,
and a series of photographs of interiors of architect studios.
Yes, right.
And even there's a series even have an interesting name.
Weltbildnis.
Weltbildnis. Now I tried to, my German is but I had some ideas about how to translate it, but it's hard to translate it to English.
Uh-huh. It's a very kind of ancient word. It's the picture of the work. This was I called this early series wasn't my favorite, but the early series. But where I had this idea that they later will develop more and more, and also to come to this work here, showing through the interior, the individual that is active there, that is created there, and making the question, can you not see what you are familiar with in this interior? Familiar with, because I like to select known individuals, maybe not the individual by itself, but its production, his production, the reproduction. So you're familiar with the architects. I selected 20 famous architects or photographers because you knew their work about having seen them in magazines or even in exhibitions. So I made the questions, listen, can't you imagine, or do you see his artwork or his architecture in the space I was going to have access to photograph it?
So just
sorry, if I can make it now very fast, this jump over. And to me, the palettes are a B-dimensional studio. it's the essence. I mean, you can go into an artist studio, you will see many things that remember you to this artist, but I think the palette by itself, it's the most intimate area, or it's the first place where the individual expels or shows itself or realizes itself, not as with consciousness like later when he's having his studio and placing around his objects, but here it happens the first time. So this is the first artist studio to me.
So just to be clear, so we were talking about an earlier work, which are views of the interior of the workspaces of well-known architects and photographers, but without the person. The person is absent.
Without the sitter.
So it's a portrait. It's a portrait without a sitter, right? Yeah. The idea is that it's a portrait through an environment. There's a kind of displacement, which is an expressive displacement and a displacement of sensibility and a very interesting slide between the person and a place. And where I was going, and you went there, is that, as far as I know, is this the first series that you began which was of objects as opposed to places, or one of the early ones?
Yes.
Okay, so, very good. So, the question is that what happens then when you go, what happens to this displacement of this slide when it's no longer the workspace of the person, which is the portrait of the person, but it is a familiar kind of object or tool, which is a tool of studio practice.
I love the palette. You know, it's being with the palette. Sure, in this moment, or when I get the access to it, when I find it, when I get the permission to, it brings me so much because this intimacy, even. Yeah, okay, also artist studios have an intimacy when you go in. I agree, I still go in artist studios and see them. But, or maybe it's to me too. Meanwhile, I love going really in the details because I see in the details what I see also in the large scale. But if you have an object that is then, also here, very linked to the body of the artist by himself and where there's not so much consciousness or no consciousness while it is in the space. So I have the sensation I can come closer to this guy, to this individual, to this painter.
How did you get started with the idea of photographing palettes?
How did I start with this idea? Yeah, so strangely with a living artist, because as you see, as you have seen, I have only artists that died before, much before I came to photograph their palettes. Mm-hmm. But with Cy Twombly, I started by a pure coincidence. Well, doesn't exist coincidence, but I knew him. I was several times in Gaeta visiting him without interest and having being already equipped and to photograph anything. But knowing his work, and at a certain point I came to see his palette, and it talked to me. I'm sure I saw before palettes somewhere, because you see sometimes palettes. But it was in a private, and it was in his context. So, and I thought, huh, that's it, that's him, there it is. And I didn't photograph it in this moment, I was also without. It took me a little bit to be convinced to go, and I thought, so what, because I always think about doing a series, it means I need more, and where would I bring it, and where are the palettes around? So I liked it, and then shortly after, I heard about a Miro palette, and then I thought, and I saw the Miro palette, and I thought, well, let's try it out. And then I asked if I can photograph it, and there were two palettes, and in total four images, because he used them also on the back. So, and that was the start. But luckily, it was also a palette where you get a lot of connection to his paintings. I mean, sometimes you see palettes where it doesn't happen. So luckily, I saw a palette that talked to me, so that it was, that this idea, ideas, what are ideas? Ideas are moments of a process. And in this moment, while always talking about investigating or capturing or asking about individuums, how can I approach them? you know, in this moment it happened that there was something that talked to me visually.
How do you find your specimens?
My specimens?
The different examples.
You mean the objects?
The objects.
How do I find them? Mm-hmm. By working. by working, by talking. So, I mean, there are many, it's different. So, also by coincidence, I go in a bookshop and I pull out catalogs, exhibition catalogs, most certain kind of exhibition catalogs where I already, it's like travel hunting. I already have the sensation it could be. This happened recently in Vienna, and I found a Hodler palette because it was not in the show, but it was in the catalog. So this is wonderful moments are when friends are writing, oh, Matthias, I'm here and here, and I saw in the vitrine a palette of, and they sent me an image already. Mm-hmm. Then nice people who really love the series and they are out like me and they're curious and asking even people or then even more when a nice situation was when I came into the Matisse family where Pierre Matisse was a collector, he had quite a lot, and then when they liked the project or when they even say, listen, finally somebody takes care of palettes, and then they take the phone and call, listen, haven't you seen, are you sure? Or could you open the door to Matthias, for Matthias to this and this person, because there might be a palette. So there are various sources to arrive there. Mm-hmm. They're mostly, especially the French ones, the French have a high attention to palettes, I have to say, to make in comparison to other countries. So in French institutions, and this all by internet, you know, I found also quite a lot of going into museums, collections, their archives. So also by internet that I go. This is then the really working thing where I sit down and go by internet up and down. Mm-hmm.
And very often you work at large scale in your photography, big prints. Now, one question for me is what do you like about large scale in photography? Because we have to remember we're looking at photographs, right? We're not looking at palettes.
Oh, right? Can I tell you? All right.
Yeah,
continue.
And the first question is what attracts you to large scale? Not always, but sometimes. And what is large scale good for with the subject of the palette?
We talk really about photography and how I use photography in this case. Well, large scale, I'm photographing this moment a series where I go really in a detail of a huge thing. And as I like more and more details, I think I can show something you wouldn't see if I blow it then up. Mm-hmm. Because,
magnification.
Yeah.
An important idea.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But in this case, it's really there's a strategy behind, because as I said, listen, I want to liberate it from its natural format to make it understand that it is more than only a tool or accumulation of paint. I should bring it out of its normal scale. Mm. It's also difficult. I don't know if it also works very good or not, because if you reproduce simple an object. You know, it's my most, photographically, my most simple series I did so far, because usually I come much more into creating an image. In this case, I don't create so much an image. I do photography in its purest, in its minimal, with its technical possibilities, and then I stop. I reproduce, which is one of the powers of photography, and then I enlarge it. So it's a document, it's a documentation, which is one characteristic of photography, and the other one, you know, I make it big to stress out what I want to say, not to make it big.
So let's keep that idea of the documentation, because I think it's very important in the whole. Well, it's a fundamental idea of photography, but it's also important in the approach. So I noticed that the earliest palette here is a Delacroix palette, I think, in this room. And that's the one next to, on the right side of that doorway there. It's a little bit different from the other palettes because it's a fully loaded palette. It shows all of Delacroix's colors all arranged as he thought you should arrange colors. It's a systematic palette. The others are more palettes of use. They're messed up, right? You can see that they've been used as tools. And they take you all the way up towards the late 20th century with Cy Twombly. So although there are no living artists here, it's really a history of 19th and 20th century artist palettes is what we have assembled here, which you could say is a kind of modern history of the palette. That's quite interesting to me, because palettes have a history. Palettes also, as you just said, are things which are sometimes collected. And this idea, and you in a way have collected palettes in your photographs, so that's interesting. Before you were a photographer, you did some studies, right? What field were you in?
I studied palettes. So I did I studied cultural anthropology.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you want to bring me?
Well, I was wondering if you think the study of cultural anthropology, first of all, what is cultural anthropology as a perspective? That's a question. But do you think it's relevant to your photography, and do you think it's relevant to your photographs of palettes?
Yeah, so I had a hurtful moment, and like
not from me.
So I studied the cultural anthropology and started then going into a PhD, a Doktorarbeit,
mm-hmm.
about visual anthropology.
Mm-hmm.
Visual anthropology, but photography. Visual anthropology is film and photography. And it was about, and I started already, to document religious feasts in South Italy,
mm-hmm.
and to compare my material I'm producing with historic material. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to discuss the visual document, but also the one who is producing the documents, because you know, to me, this is Clifford Geertz, this is the American anthropology where they first time studied documents, but written documents, and I wanted to bring this into the visual document. So I started photographing it. I got from my doctor, from my professor in Hamburg, in Appoggio. The support.
Support.
He had to write all the papers that I got the from DAAD, the money to do them. And so I started photographing, traveling, and first time I came back showing him my work, my photographs, he said it's too artistic. And he said he wouldn't proceed supporting me because I don't know if after a year or after half a year he had to renew, you know, the request, the idea to get more money
for your fellowship.
For my fellowship, and he said he wouldn't do that because it's not an anthropological photography. Mm. And at this moment, it was terrible for me because you know I was standing there. It's over. You know, I thought now it's over.
Mm.
And in this moment, I was working also with a Sapienza in Rome with a professor for anthropology, and he gave me also all support because he loved the German. Well, I don't want to go too much into German anthropology, which was a little bit delayed in the corridor. And so I had to stop. I had to go to work also. And I worked also as an anthropologist, but I had to go to work, and I went to a publisher. A photography publishing house in Munich, Schirmer Mosel, where then I was very close to mostly to the German photography, and it was such a switch, but it was also a lucky moment that I could go there where there was a high quality of photography, and this really changed me. This hurtful moment when he said no, you will not, brought me into, but I kept this anthropological sensibility or questioning, creating, you know, being in the documentary photography, but bringing up something that is just the beginning to discuss or to think.
So one of the angles I think of this kind of anthropological visual anthropology is that you take into account the position of the maker of the document.
Yeah.
Right? You pay attention not only to the subject matter of the document, but you also think about the point of view of the person who has made the photograph.
Yeah, the object photograph was not the end of the trip.
Yes.
It was the beginning. And this is also what drives to me. I mean, I'm inviting with the palette that the people come and start thinking mostly looking at it. You know, this is simply, it's a going, maybe like the hole. It's a going through, you know, from here you go and then you activate your visual memory to, you know, or you really create you get in confrontation with yourself, but not being so much busy with yourself, but going much more out, thinking about works of Cy Twombly, really, and not Cy Twombly, wow, so famous now on art market, you know, all this, you don't get so much influenced by this, but much more, why is he there? Why is Cy Twombly? What does he produce? What did he produce? So, and the palette is, in this case, then to me, a tool again, mm-hmm. You know, that I, oh, nice, that I use a tool to make it become a tool of thinking,
But I'm interested in looking at it the other way around. So, yes, I care about Cy Twombly, but I also care about Matthias. So, because you are the maker of the photograph.
Yeah, but I'm the producer of the idea, and then I do my banal, my necessary. I have to take my decisions, which is not some part, but I use my photographic skills and propose it. You don't offer it and listen and say, listen, go and look. So, and here, this is Matthias, and no more in this case.
Mm-hmm. I see. So, the idea that the palette tells you something about the artist is one of the great truisms of thinking about palettes, right? So there's an idea that the palette can give you information about the sensibility or the style of an artist in a special way, because the artist touched it, because it's part of the intimate process of mixing paint and then moving it from one surface to another surface and the image and so forth. That's one of the ideas that I think this series speaks to, and you just said it yourself. Another great truism is that another great truism about palettes, especially in the modern period, is that palettes might be considered to be like works of art. For example, the great abstract painter Vasily Kandinsky in the early part of the 20th century said something like, now I'm quoting, don't quote me, I'm paraphrasing, right? Said something like, the palette is the most beautiful picture ever made. Now, how is it possible, under what conditions could the premise that the palette is itself a thing to look at with as expressive, under what conditions could that idea exist only in the modern period, I think, really? You have to have the idea that the materials of paint by themselves can speak to you. You have to have the idea that colors have a sound inside them that will resonate with you. You have to have an ideal of a kind of direct expression. Right? Do you think those ideas are valid now that you have had the experience of making this series?
Yeah, but I don't know exactly what you mean.
Well, the idea that a palette by itself is expressive.
Yeah.
The idea that the palette has its own beauty. The idea that the palette gives you access to something about the maker, the artist who used it. These are some of the big truisms. And what I want to know is, where do you think this series of works stands in relation to those ideas?
Well, it stands then there when I have, for example, of one artist, several palettes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then I have to take a decision, and then are these questions coming to me, you know. Mm-hmm. Where is it very interesting on the one side, but on the other side also very beautiful, because you know, I think you attract the interest through beautiness. So then I go into it and look out what satisfies my criteria about that. Mm-hmm. Sure, what I don't have is, you know, I'm looking for certain artists. I have always quite renowned artists to really involve a bigger group of people. I cannot show palettes of some friends I have, but in America nobody knows the artwork of them. But when I go into research, I forgot what I want to say. When I go into the research, the criteria is definitely that I get at least a lot of paint on the palette. You know, even if I don't, there are painters I never heard before. Later I photographed the palette and I got into to understand that they are important for this. Mm-hmm. But my criteria is really to have, the first word thing is that to have paint that talk then by their own and independent of how I see it. I have palettes, I wouldn't say I would like to have them hanging in my home and seeing them daily, but I think they're important to have in the series. Mm-hmm.
Do you want to open up to questions? Okay. Well, I think we've thrown out some big topics here, so we were hoping that there might be some chance for some discussion with you all.
I have a question, Matthias. Do you maybe it's not in this room, but do you have a favorite palette because of the surprise in seeing it or the surprise after you made it? Is there something, you said there's certain palettes you might not live with. Would you want to live with any of these images in the room?
I have several palettes. They are my favorites for different categories. You know, category of beautiness, category of information. Let's turn it like this, when a collector comes to me, which one should I take, or which one is your mm-hmm. favorite? So I did the book, and I'm happy with my book that I can go through and look them however my mood is. I don't have a favorite one.
But if the collector comes to you, I would think that the collector would have one that they are looking for. If I just saw the list of artists, I would be attracted to certain artists on that list. I mean, the collector doesn't have an idea of who they would
be. They have various ideas. They have already at home some De Chirico, and they want to add a palette of De Chirico. Or to me, it's also funny to see how come si dice, I sessi diversi, no? Maschio, donna,
the different genders of
the how different genders are going. What are they going for? This is
so is there a male and a female taste?
Yeah. These are curiosity I'm following when a collector comes, but I couldn't tell anyone go for this or that.
So are you continuing the series or have you stopped the series?
I continue this archaeology, how I call it, or this truffle hunting. You mentioned before that there are more than 200 in this moment of 86 painters, mostly Europeans. Don't ask me why. Well, you know, when you go into a... I initially wanted to do only some, because it's just about the idea, you know, it continues then. But it's like, you know, if you once lived close to a music conservatorio, it's like, you know, constantly somebody is making this attitude. Then at a certain point, it becomes really an exercise to me, and no more. So I continue. I set to myself 100 to have a deadline, but Europe, but there's always also the United States, and then also the question coming closer to the contemporary art, where the palette changes.
Matthew, I mean, I'm curious, I mean, when I originally called you and asked if you would like to be available to do a conversation, I didn't know of the depth and breadth of your sort of knowledge of palettes. Does that come from your art history training, or is that a sort of natural curiosity that you have from being an art historian?
It's just an unfortunate byproduct of too much time on my hands. No, I'm just joking. Palettes are interesting to me because they are about color. And color is one of the fundamental, elements of the visual arts. But it's also one of the most poetic and metaphorical and sort of fundamental questions that you have to deal with when you're describing or trying to understand the way an artist works. So if you ever tried to describe a work of art, if you ever tried to understand an artist's method, you're going to go to the palette as an idea, because a palette is not just a tool, it's also a metaphor, right? Artists have palettes, meaning they have colors they gravitate towards, or arrangements of colors that they like. A palette is also a symbol of the artist's profession. Daumier did a great caricature in the 19th century of the battle of the genres, I think, between the sculptors and the painters. And the painter was there with the palette as a shield, right? I mean, the palette is just a fundamental idea and cultural artifact that if you spend your time working on the history of painting, it would be difficult not to bump into it. And I would say that this conversation has given me an opportunity to try to pull a few things together in a coherent way, but I think Matthias wants to jump in.
Yeah, but also, how the artist, the painter by himself, takes the palette to make a self-portrait. But some in beautiful cases, they really show it,
Yes, you should
like
make it. Yes.
Like the carte de visite, they really are kind of, I wouldn't say aggressive, but it's not, they don't treat it just like a tool. They just have it somewhere around, but it makes really this beautiful, a Cézanne of his studio, where on the top on the right is a small palette painted there. Or from Duchamp, there's a wonderful Mona Lisa, where he cut out of a piece of paper a palette and put it on the bottom of the Mona Lisa. So it's for them also not just only a tool, it's a kind of metaphor, symbol.
It's a very resonant kind of object.
Yeah.
And actually palettes are everywhere if you notice them. So this is an opportunity to notice them, which I think is very nice.
The one palette that I wasn't surprised by, now that I'm saying this, I'm not surprised, was the Yves Klein palette. Yeah, this is like, and I was curious, Matthias, it's almost like, what is there to photograph? I mean, you could photograph anything with Yves Klein as long as it was blue, we would have believed you. But was there somebody's palette that you were truly surprised to see it, knowing their work? Because that one didn't surprise me at all. Yeah, what else could it be?
Yeah, in that case, you didn't. Because it was the color, but it was a plate, which was a surprising thing. But at a certain point, but this is when you come closer to. No, I wasn't surprised. I mean, really not surprised. I mean, sure, with the Van Gogh, it was wonderful to get this intensity. To feel this intensity, Max Beckmann, we don't have it, which is nearly completely black, where even there's some color, some red, whatever, but it's good. So when the palette really goes to the extreme or to the essentials, what I would consider the essential of these individuals that they selected. Then it excites me a lot. But with Yves Klein, it's not about palette; it's simply about color.
Right. But Matthew, that sort of begs the question. Do you have palettes that you look at in the Philadelphia Museum's collection a lot, or seldom, or always, or?
Okay, now you're embarrassing me because I actually don't know if we have any palettes in the collection.
Say that again?
I don't actually know if we have any palettes in the collection of the Philadelphia Museum of Art, but I know that there are collections. For example, there's a place called the Salma Gundi Club in New York, which is where a famous literary journalist is published, and they have a whole collection of artists' palettes, and there are other places where they are collected. And that's very interesting because it tells you that palettes are part of the cultural history, the broader cultural history of art. They're souvenirs, they're relics of people, and that's one of the lessons of
this. And I can defend you because it happens sometimes that I reach out to a curator, and when they like the idea, they say, listen, let me make a research. They go to the register or somewhere, and they say, yeah, we have a palette, you know, then take some days or whatever. Therefore I call it archaeology, because they are underground. They exist, but they just have to be pulled out of a box in the museum or wherever. And therefore, I have get also the support very often from museums that say, oh, wonderful, somebody is getting interested in the palettes. We have them, but nobody is asking for them or doing anything. Or they simply end up in the vitrine next to the La Pipa.
It's part of the equipment of the studio.
Yes.
I thought I saw a hand up in the back.
Yeah, like three great ones that we put along. Mm-hmm. I'm just kidding. First of all, thank you for presenting these objects, Alex. You're amazing. That really got me thinking. So thank you. Through the tying back to the surprises, is it one that you took that before you took the photograph of, and then afterwards you saw something else that was different, the result was different, or something else stood out once you blew up your photograph?
If the result was different to what I saw?
Correct. Yeah, did the photograph highlight something differently than the naked eye when you first were taking a look at it?
Yeah. They change, this is true. This is, it's better to be with them in somewhere alone instead of putting them into the frame. In sense of, I make them more abstract than they are in their reality. I mean, by putting them in a frame and wider, they lose a little bit of their, you know, charisma, of their, also regarding, if I have understood well your question, also regarding the colors, you know, sometimes the palettes are in a quite bad shape, in sense of they're dusty, you know, like paintings sometimes are also that the colors are gone, are sit down, and then we work really by Photoshop and getting examples, or with the color scale I have next to the palette when I photograph it, then we try to go to come to colors that are seem to be more real than, you know, what the restorator has to do when he has to work on a, so then they change a little bit. Sometimes I can say hello again to the palettes because continuing traveling and going into shows, they show up in vitrines and I see them again and I think, huh, look at this, my photograph is somehow has not this intimacy, or even with the colors that there's a different, depends also how they are exposed in the vitrines, how they are aligned. So it's working, it's a continuity.
And is there one palette out there that you haven't been allowed to photograph, or that you're looking most forward to, or is there a palette out there that you were not allowed to photograph?
Yes, I have in this moment a very painful situation. There's a palette, I know it, and I don't get access to it. Mm-hmm. But I have to try to, I will continue. I have already people working on this subject, on this individuum to let me come in. But I have also painful situations. I mean, I should really talk once to an archaeologist, to if we share same suffer. but you know, an archaeologist, he knows he has to go there in this hectares, and then he has to go down and has to get the money to can go further down. But I don't know where the pallets are. You know, where could they be? I mean, sure, I think my email address is known in many museums or foundations, but you know, sometimes they have their lives that the artist gave it to the collector who bought it or other. So they have their own, they go far away somewhere. So I continue, and I have still in my list some very, to me, important painters I would like to have in.
Well, best of luck with
that. Thank you very much. I mean, if you know a palette, if you see a palette.
I'll keep an eye out now.
Thank you. Could you see yourself at some point photographing tools of artists other than painters?
Cannot respond to it right now. I mean, I like sculpture. Mm. I even did recently a work on Canova, where it is about his technique, or which was not only his technique, but he did a self-portrait. But I didn't work on the tool. I didn't work on the tools. I worked much more how he placed the points on his face to copy the model into his final material. No, so I don't know. I was curious about musicians. Mm. I did two works so far on scores, music scores, where it is more, it goes a little bit in the other direction. There's also the graphic notes, the graphical writing, where I'm asking if the composer is not bringing the sound in his handwriting in, you know. So I worked on Schubert, Lindenbaum, on the Winterreise Lindenbaum, but it's very, you know, there I'm really interpreting. They really go in and I pull out what I want to see, hear and not. I just show it and let you do your trip. But with the scores and the music scores, I photographed also one of Verdi. There's one in the Morgan Library of Beethoven, you know, where I have my ideas about the music and also about the musician. And then I'm looking where on the page I could find documents about that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Go ahead.
So first, just a question about palettes in general. Do artists use palettes, or is it a one-time thing?
Well, I think they reuse them.
I think it depends also on his state of economy.
Yeah.
Mm. I mean,
these are not the questions. They are very, you know, delicate in the sense of very right to understand the palette or to understand, for example, the Delacroix. You see that it was used before this palette, and. When he let, when Delacroix or the others went, I don't know in which moment they let the palette stand like they are, in which moment they were. And even are, so very, very interesting, these questions. The other thing is, I have rarely dates of the palettes from when they are, only in two cases. And in another two cases, it's known the painting of this palette. Then it becomes,
that was my other question, was do you have any idea what paintings?
There are some artists, and Delacroix is one, who actually had a palette tuned to a particular composition. And sometimes, because he was such an important artist in his time, it's even recorded. And then to follow up, you know, there are types of palettes. So these are mostly working palettes, but there are demonstration palettes, meaning palettes which are prepared not to be used, but to demonstrate the particular method that a particular artist uses to lay out and arrange the colors. So that's like a pedagogical thing. And there are even pictorial palettes where you take a palette, but instead of leaving just the colors morph into a picture, and that could be a souvenir, and then you wouldn't reuse that, right? So there are, so partly this is a question of the genres of palettes and the purposes that to which they're put.
Matthew, Matthias.
Matthias,
thank you very much. I think you should take this show on the road. I'll be waiting for the next installment in Wichita. So anyway,
thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much.